Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Deadly, Book 1, Nude, written by Morris Gleitzman and Paul Jennings, and read by Melissa Eccleston and Francis Greenslade. Be sure to visit our website at www.belinda.com. Details of other available and forthcoming Belinda audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording. Sprocket. Chapter 1. There were three things for sure. I was naked, I didn't know who I was, and I needed to go to the loo. Stones cut into my cold, bare feet as I hobbled across the narrow hillside track. I made my way to a rocky clearing and squatted down behind a tree. It would have to do. There was no toilet and no paper. But when you have to go, you have to go. Ah, I said. That's better. I cleaned myself up as best I could with some leaves from a shrub. Then I picked up a handful of dirt to cover the large lump of poo I had deposited there. Drop that! Snapped a voice from behind me. I turned around and saw a boy about 6 years old with a pretty face and curly blonde hair. He wore an outfit like a jungle fighter. Not dress-ups, the real thing. Only pint-sized. The dirt fell from my hand as I stared at him with astonishment. Hey! I said. Where did you come from? Where's your mummy? Maybe I could help him and he could help me. I had woken with the dawn, naked on the grass. That's all I knew about myself. He didn't answer. He was an odd little kid. In one hand he held a small spoon, and in the other a mobile phone. He flicked the phone open, pressed a couple of buttons and spoke quickly into it. He's here, he said into the phone. About half a kilometre along the track. He glanced at my half-covered poop. And he's done a nice big one. A look of annoyance crossed his face and he began jabbing away at the buttons with his fingers. You're breaking up, he yelled into the phone. He began pacing around trying to find a spot with better reception. Suddenly he threw the phone down on the ground and jumped on it. Pathetic, he shouted. Cheap rubbish! It's all right, Titch, I told him. Your mummy can't be far away. Don't get upset. We'll find her. Maybe his mother could also help me. At least she might have some clothes I could borrow. I tried to sound relaxed, but I was worried. What was his mum going to say when she saw me in the nude? The angelic little boy had a devilish smile. He didn't appear surprised that I was naked, and he seemed to know who I was. Just you stay there, son, he said. You're not going to get away this time. Talk about weird. He should have been at kindergarten doing a finger painting or having milk and fruit, not standing here in the rainforest ordering me around like a bossy bank manager. Maybe he was a relation. Maybe he was my little brother. He had hard eyes. But perhaps I had hard eyes too. I didn't even know what I looked like. It was a terrible feeling. Do you know me? I asked.
Just you take it easy, he answered. There's no one around here to help you. Think about it. Consider your options. All alone in the bush, naked with no food. Better to give yourself up. This is rough country. You need clothes.
He was right. The morning sun was just beginning to rise and I was shivering in the cool morning air. And embarrassed. He talked funny for a little kid. The words seemed too big for his mouth. I started to feel uneasy. But surely this little boy couldn't hurt me. He was only half my size. The angel-faced brat reached into his pocket and took out a large white handkerchief.
I think you have something that belongs to me, he said.
He was crazy. I was stark naked. I had no pockets. What could I possibly have that belonged to someone else? Dimples appeared in his rosy cheeks. He grinned with delight, dropped to his knees, and spread the handkerchief out on the ground.
"Good,"
he said, motioning at my fresh piece of poop. He gently scooped it up with the spoon and placed it on the handkerchief. He looked at the big brown lump of poo with sparkling eyes, as if it was made of gold.
"Oh, yuck! He was pinching my poop, shoveling up my... Disgusting! Gross! Surely this was a dream. It must be a nightmare."
The kid was too confident for his age. His eyes were old. They seemed to know things that they shouldn't. They weren't the eyes of a child. It just didn't make sense. This couldn't be happening. At any moment I would wake up to find a smiling mother telling me that everything was all right. I made one last effort to be friendly.
"What's your name?"
I asked.
"Shut up,"
he said. He was peering down the rough hilly track. I put on a false grin.
"Okay," I said. "If you won't tell me your name, I'll call you Pooper Scooper."
He didn't reply. He was listening to the sound of an engine. An engine with a loud, unfriendly growl. Someone else was coming. Pooper Scooper jumped to his feet as a truck rumbled around the bend. It was a four-wheel drive, a khaki-coloured Hummer. A low, mean military vehicle with huge off-road tyres. It left the track and crawled right over a large rock in the clearing. I half expected to see soldiers staring through the narrow slit of its windscreen. But I couldn't see anyone. The glass was tinted black. The driver jumped out onto the long grass. A girl. She was a little kid too, about the same age as Pooper Scooper, 5 or 6 at the most. What was she doing driving a truck? She must have been sitting on a pillow just to see over the steering wheel. She wore red and blue racing car gloves, a baseball cap, and a driving jacket fit for a Formula One champion. It was covered in advertisements and bright sewn-on patches. One of them read, "Reptile." The name suited her. She licked her lips with a flicking tongue, just like a lizard about to catch a fly. Someone inside lifted a canvas flap on the back of the Hummer. 2 more infants jumped out. They were dressed in expensive walking gear. They had Nike boots and designer jeans. One wore a woolen beanie on his head. The other had spiky red hair and scowled a lot. They carried backpacks with aluminium frames. Ropes, knives and whistles hung from their belts. The knives had big blades and burnt bone handles. Everything they owned was new and shiny, state of the art. Each of them had a mobile phone strapped on at the waist. They all sported military watches and compasses. The red-haired gorilla held a large net. Each one had the same creepy, knowing eyes. I just stood there gaping at the crazy sight. And as I did, a feeling of coming danger crawled over my naked skin. An alarm bell rang inside my brain. I was naked, but they didn't seem to care. I felt like prey.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.